Good evening, everyone. My name is David Galanders. I'm an educator in the Department of Learning and Community Engagement here at the National Gallery of Canada. Welcome to this event, Histories, HIV, AIDS, and Art in Canada. Bonjour, je suis David Galanders. Je suis éducateur au département d'apprentissage et engagement communautaire ici au Musée des Beaux-Arts du Canada. Bienvenue tous et à toutes. I'm only going to speak for a minute. I'm going to try and be quick. But I do have a couple of important things to say, a tiny bit of housekeeping before we get going. Today's event is taking place in English with French simultaneous interpretation. In order to access the French audio feed, there's a button at the bottom of your Zoom window. It looks like a globe and it's got the word interpretation. If you click there, you can access the French language audio feed if you want. Now, I'm going to repeat that in French so that to be sure that everybody who wants it can use it. L'événement ce soir a lieu en anglais, mais avec une traduction simultanée en français. Si vous voulez écouter en français, vous avez l'option de cliquer sur le bouton en bas de l'écran Zoom, le bouton qui ressemble à un globe terrestre. Et là, vous avez le choix, vous pouvez choisir français pour écouter en français. I want to recognize that I'm joining you from the offices of the National Gallery of Canada here in Ottawa. The gallery is situated on the unceded, unsurrendered traditional territory of the Algonquin Anishinaabe Nation. We're grateful for the opportunity to work and to gather on these lands and for the knowledge keepers who guide and remind us of the history and significance of this place. Their stewardship of the land and their stories and culture are shaping the gallery and will continue to do so. I am delighted to bring this group of people together for this event. I promised I wasn't going to talk for a long time and I'm not going to, but I do want to at least name everybody and thank them before we start. Ted Kerr, Margaret Kisikaw Piyesis, Theodore Walker Robinson, Abdi Osman, Les Harper, thank you. Thanks for bringing your voices to this important conversation. Before the event ends, we're going to have some time for Q&A with the audience. If you want to submit questions, those are welcome in English and French and can be submitted via the Q&A button at the bottom of your Zoom window. I can't promise we'll get to all of them, but we'll do our best. What else? One other thing. Today's event is being recorded. And once the event is done, we'll tidy up the recording a little bit and put it up on the National Gallery's YouTube channel in the not too distant future. Now, I have the great pleasure of introducing Ted Kerr, who has very kindly accepted the role of moderator for this evening's conversation. Ted Kerr is an Edmonton-born writer and organizer whose work focuses primarily on HIV/AIDS. With Alexandra Juhas, he co-authored the upcoming book, We Are Having This Conversation Now, The Times of AIDS Cultural Production, from Duke University Press. He was also the curator of AIDS, Posters and Stories of Public Health, A People's History of Pandemic for the National Library of Medicine in the United States. In 2016 and 17, Ted conducted 10 interviews for the Smithsonian's Archives of American Arts, Visual Arts and the AIDS Epidemic and Oral History Project. More recently, he worked with Zoe Dodd, Les Harper, Ellen Walker, and a team from the Blackwood Gallery at the University of Toronto's Mississauga campus to create Wish You Were Here, Wish Here Was Better, a mobile project about grief, the opioid crisis, and the power of community responses. He's also a founding member of What Would an HIV Doula Do? And teaches at the New School and Manhattan College. Ted, thank you. It's all yours.
Hello. Thank you so much, David. Hi, everybody. My name is Ted Kerr. I am coming to you live from Lenape land. I am in Brooklyn, New York. For those of you who need a description, I am a white middle-aged dude who's bald with the best mustache you can imagine. I'm so honored to be hosting Histories, HIV, AIDS, and Art in Canada. And I really would love it if you can imagine that even though we are together over Zoom, that we are actually sitting at a table, maybe it's even a round table, and we are all looking at each other and talking to each other. And this is a conversation where people are jumping in and listening, and you can see heads nodding. As David mentioned, I'm part of a collective called What Would an HIV Doula Do? And one of the things that we really understand and believe is that since no one gets HIV alone, no one should have to deal with HIV alone. So this event is about an intersectional understanding that to understand the ongoing crisis is to think about art and community and politics and love and our bodies collectively. We're gonna hear from four amazing people in two rounds, and then we're gonna have a group discussion, and then we're gonna open it up to you. So please feel free to use the Q&A to ask questions, to make comments, to compliment us on our outfits or our voices, whatever you want. So the first question that everybody, that each panelist is gonna have 5 minutes to answer is, what is your relationship to art? And as you answer this question, feel free to share a little bit about yourself. We're going to start with Margaret. Margaret has been doing HIV work on this land since before 1999. Margaret, when you're ready, why don't you open your camera up and let us know about you and your relationship to art.
Thank you so much, Ted. And what a beautiful opportunity to come and to share and to speak truthfully on this land, the land of my ancestors. I'm from Treaty 4 territory in Saskatchewan. My home fire is in Regina, Saskatchewan, the capital of the province. And I live and work there. I work from all over the place. Today I'm coming to you from Victoria, BC. I'm over here witnessing one of my colleagues, the director of research and policy from CAN, Communities, Alliances, and Networks, get an honorary degree. What an opportunity and a lead for the AIDS movement in Canada as we move forward and we look as these Indigenous scholars begin to unfold and to begin to work. She's been at this for as many years as I've been at it in terms of working in the AIDS movement. And so, wonderful day today, and to come and to speak and to talk Kamasawan life to the people here. I am of Cree ancestry. I am Mayetawenoke Chitaskwayo, kind-hearted warrior woman. I have been working in HIV and AIDS for over 34 years in many different capacities. I am currently the Okama, the leader, the CEO of CAN, Communities, Alliances, and Networks. And formerly, I was the CEO of All Nations Hope Network in Saskatchewan. I led a provincial Indigenous AIDS organization. I've been involved for many years in this movement. The virus is only 40 years old on this land. And so as we move forward, we're looking for solutions to what we face here as Indigenous people through our Indigenous lenses, through our Indigenous ways of knowing and doing as we begin to unfold and the many solutions that lie here right from our ancestors. I think about art in many different forms, of course. Early on in the HIV/AIDS movement, we began to identify many opportunities we had to bring messages across. And, you know, one of the earliest ones I think of is the quilts that we also made quilts for as Indigenous people to remember those that lived and died of AIDS here on this land. I was involved early on in the movement. I was very interested as an Indigenous woman. My role and responsibility to take care of life as a life giver was important to me. I seen the discrimination, the ignorance, the racism, the stigma that was associated with HIV. I also had opportunity to be mentored by a local AIDS organization in Regina, AIDS Regina, and was able to listen to what was going on. And then to know that my ancestors, my family would be impacted by this dis-ease that came to this land. But again, just a little over 40 years ago. And to look for solutions that would move forward, that this was a dis-ease that we would learn to live with, live beside, and to have respect for, and to know that as we move forward today, back in the early days to where we are today, a lot has changed. And so there's been a lot of opportunities for us to share the knowledge in many different forms. I've also been involved over the years in many different research projects that were art-based. I'm also a traditional medicine practitioner, which means I've made a commitment in my life to take care of medicines and to know a bit more about the medicines that are on the land. And I've seen some of the art forms that come. We've got the red ribbon, but we've also incorporated some of our medicines into the red ribbon. We use some sweetgrass and we incorporate that in with the red ribbon and the meaning of what the red ribbon is today on this land. I've been able to know that the art that I speak about comes in many forms. It comes in the forms of some of the sacred items or the tools that have been given to us through the work that we do that help to bring life in together in ceremonies. When we're looking for solutions, the medicines and the ceremonies are very important. Our singing, our drumming, our opportunities that we bring forward, some of our sacred items, our eagle feathers, our pipes, some of the forms that I know of and I practice because I'm a Cree from the prairies. And so I understand our art form, even as in form of our ceremonies, our sweat lodge that we go in ceremony in is so important to us as we begin to look for and seek healing in our journeys of wellness and seeking that on the land once more. And to bring those forward to the teachings that we have here on this land. Our ancestors were well equipped to be able to bring that to life here. And we continue on with our Indigenous ways of knowing and doing and bringing those to life. So thank you so much for that.
Wow, Margaret, thank you for starting us off that way. I can't imagine a better way than to share this vast understanding of what art can mean, whether it's through listening, through medicine, through messaging. Thank you so much. I'm going to throw it now to Les. Les, let us know about you and your relationship to art.
Danse, bonjour. I'm here to talk today about art and HIV and our communities. I come from Saddle Lake, Alberta, on my mother's side, Pauline Shirt, and my father, Vern Harper, I'm from Mistawasis, Saskatchewan. Both Plains Cree, grew up traditionally into my culture, brought up Sundance, sweats, ceremonies, everything, powwow, all the things that I was very fortunate to have that many people weren't in the Native community. And what came with that was art was a big thing in the that world. But in social work, I started working in this field when I was 17 years old. How I started was I was involved with institutions and in and out, and it wasn't going so well for me. So my father helped me get work at a overnight shelter, and I started working in that field. I'm 50 years old now. My name's Les Harper, and I'm very proud of my upbringing from my mother, my father, my grandparents, and that's one thing that we do in our way is that we acknowledge where we come from or who we are and that background. To us, that's a way that we do that to be polite, to say, well, this is where I'm from. You see a lot of Indigenous people will do that. You see that, oh, where are you from when they first meet. And that's just a greeting that we do. It's like, because we want to know each other. We want to reach each other in a positive way. Oh, you're from Saskatchewan, and oh, you're from here, and I've been here, and I have another fellow Cree on this panel. Love it. And that's great to hear that. And then it makes me feel more comfortable in who I am and what I am, and knowing other people are involved in the same, outlooks of life and been through so many of the same things. I've worked at Passan. I've worked in prisons on all things, helping things change for Indigenous people on HIV and AIDS and Hep C. that was one big thing. And one of the greatest things that helped with that was art. I love art. I think it's something that is, comes in so many forms, and it can create such a doorways of opening up things. And I always say that it's really important. There's so many doorways that we can open, and we have a choice to open that doorway and go through that doorway, or where we choose not to. But we also have doorways we see we could go through, but we don't want to go through those doorways because we see those difficulties. So when hopefully in our journeys, we help people, each other are going through that journey together, because we are together. We are not alone. And I like that how you said that, Ted, that we are together. And through this, we're sitting here together in that circle. Oh, it's so important. You know, I have to say, I just want to pay respects and my love and great feelings for Christian Marshall, who just passed away the other day. Norvell Marshall. Actually, you see paintings behind me of Norvell's. He passed away, and he was a great artist in our community and a great advocate of our community. And one of the things I believe in harm reduction and a lifestyle, I'm a person that identifies as somebody that has and will use alcohol or drugs. That's not a big form in our indigenous community. And so I try to bring that and find the ways that we could, you know, celebrate those things. You know, that's one thing that we have. And a lot of our people use alcohol, drugs, and they're beautiful people. And we need ways to keep everybody safe. There is no safe place. My friend Denise Baldwin told me one time, but we try to make it safe as possible. And that's what we're trying to do right now as talking here, and how important that is, and talk through mediums of art and through those connections with each other. And so I think that's an amazing thing that to be able to do that today. So I say, miigwech. Hi, hi.
Thank you so much, Les. We just got to work on a project together, so it's so nice to be in this space with you in this digital circle, and it was so beautiful to see the art behind you. It was really special. I'm going to throw it now to Abdi. Abdi, you have 5 minutes. Tell us about yourself and your relationship to art. Thank you.
Oh, hi, my name is Abdi Osman, and I am a multidisciplinary artist living here based in Toronto. My work is mostly on documenting the Black diaspora. And my work focuses on the questions of Black masculinity as it intersects with Muslim and queer identities. So as a multidisciplinary artist, I practice photography, filmmaking, montage, drawing, and painting. My paintings and drawings have been positioned as what I call African primitivism. I work with the definition of primitive art that centers on the idea that the pre-colonial art of the colonized was deemed primitive by the colonizers. The colonial logic that pre-contact African art was ugly, misproportioned, and distorted is what I take as the incitement to do my work. Rather than attempt to disapprove the colonial idea of the unattractiveness of African art, I embrace the ugly and the distorted. In my drawing and painting practice, deformity, differently proportioned scales, and distorted and missharpened bodily parts as part of countering the discourse of African art as primitive. My drawing and painting inhabits this African grotesque, turning it against itself, and thereby highlight now African art is another way of seeing the world. To draw and paint with the demand of perfection is a liberating act. Indeed, the kind of art that I make is a direct confrontation with the polished and smooth aesthetics of Western modern art. As we know, European modernist high art was liberally borrowed or appropriated the aesthetics of the colonized and formerly colonized. In that borrowing, what was considered ugly, primitive, and unformed, is transformed into an intellectual exercise meant to give to European art what it is assumed primitive art could never have. My painting and drawings practice by returning firmly to the primitive is a direct engagement with the claim, with this claim, and a rebuking of it at the same time. So that is it in terms of my practice and what I'm working on at the moment. Oh, you're muted.
That's amazing. That's the best part of being on Zoom, is being muted. It's so wonderful. What I was saying, Abdi, was thank you so much for that. And as we get ready to talk to Theo, what I'm thinking about is how lovely it is that we are all getting a chance to really broaden our relationship and our understanding of art, as each one of the panelists described that. So Abdi, you're going to shut down your camera, and I'm going to stay on until Theo comes up. So Theo, please, that's awesome. And we're going to hear from you. And let us know about yourself and your relationship to art.
Great. Fantastic. Thank you, everyone. Abdi, Les, Margaret. Such a wonderful crowd to be in the company of. Ted, I just feel so honored to be here this evening. David, thank you so much for calling us all together to have such an important conversation about arts and HIV. I'm so glad to know that there are people who understand that this conversation is not over, that the HIV/AIDS epidemic is not over. And there are so many different divergent points for discussion about this. But anyways, a little bit about me. My name is Theodore Walker Robinson. I go by they, them pronouns. I identify as a Black, trans, non-binary, trans feminist, eco-feminist, artist, multidisciplinary artist. I'm also the executive director of Lakeshore Arts, which is a local art service organization serving the Etobicoke, South Etobicoke area in Toronto. And we connect communities to local artists and help our communities to experience change and transformation through creativity. And what connects me to art as an artist, as an educator, is that transformative nature of creative expression. I've been an artist, a multidisciplinary artist throughout my life, but as the pandemic came upon us in the past 3 to 4 years, it really came to a point in my life as a mid-career artist where I found myself in my basement alone for 2 years, becoming radicalized regarding certain issues that were of interest to people like myself, people who were Black, people who are trans, non-binary, people who were socialized as women, people who experienced exclusion as a result of periodic illness, of disability, and things like that, issues like that came to the forefront for me during the pandemic. And it began to influence my art, it began to influence my politics, and it began to influence the way I approached community. I found myself actually being pushed out into the forefront of social activism and politics, and I became someone in the harm reduction community who stood up in the federal election of the past year, being an advocate for someone who, for those who are typically on the margins of society, those who fall within categories that tend to be overlooked by dominant streams of society. But anyways, the work that I do is so much related to the transformative nature of art, just because of how much it's impacted my life as someone who does work in activism within the harm reduction and HIV/AIDS community. I do serve on a board of directors for Moyo Health and Community Services, which is a leading HIV/AIDS and harm reduction service organization serving the region of Peel, and it's just doing amazing work right now in terms of offering compassionate care for those who use intravenous drugs, for those who are living with HIV, for those who are exploring their gender, for those, again, who are living on the margins of society, for those who are impacted by the stigma of HIV and AIDS. And so as someone who comes to the table with so many intersecting identities that are impacted, that touch the conversation of HIV and AIDS, I feel as though my voice is definitely valid at the table, and I think it's a voice that needs to be heard when it comes to contributing to an intersectional conversation. So, as an artist, as an educator, it's always been my mission to speak to the transformative nature of creative expression, especially for those who are in experiences of periodic illness, those who are in the experience of living with HIV and AIDS, with disability, with trans experience, and those also within recovery, the recovery community. Oh, you're muted again, Ted.
Welcome, Ted, to Zoom. Theo, thank you so much for that, especially naming all the ways that intersectionality is so important to this conversation. And when we get into the group discussion, I hope you'll share even more about that. And maybe we can all talk about our intersectional understandings of HIV. Now I have my next question. So now we're going to do round two, and we're going to start again with Margaret. And the question this time, the first question was, what is your relationship to art? Now this round, I would love to hear, what is your relationship to HIV?
Thank you so much. I don't know if it's good to go first or good to go last, but anyway, I think I kind of shared it early on. I've always been an activist at heart, even when I was a little girl. And I think some of the things that I was raised with was my father always called me his little boss. And we tell our children what they're going to be as we raise them, and we call them things. And so I was called the boss. And so today I'm the Okama, the leader of CAN, Communities, Alliances, and Networks. And, in the past, I was a leader of the All Nations Hope Network in Saskatchewan for over 25 years and still working there too. So there's a lot of things as we move forward, I think about in terms of the work that I've been doing. I have my early work in this area, in the area of HIV and AIDS, was because I seen so much ignorance, stigma, discrimination, racism associated with people and around HIV, but also being indigenous. And so Saskatchewan, coming from here, there's a lot of racism here in this on this land for Indigenous people. And so we're directly impacted on a daily basis. And I am, as even as in the state of where I've risen to in terms of the work that I do and my status in the community, I still experience racism on a regular basis. And so when I begin to look at why I moved into this area of work, I'm always someone that would stand up for people being treated unfairly or being treated poorly. So when HIV came, the opportunity to write a report in one of my Indigenous health study classes at the, back then it was the Saskatchewan Indian Federated College in Regina, which is now the First Nations University of Canada, I wanted to write on AIDS. And so I went to the local agency and sat with them and got some information, and they really interest me. In terms of the work that they were doing in such a disease at that time, back in 1988, that was not being talked about, not being supported. There was a lot of activism going on. There was a lot of the early rise of people talking about HIV and to keep talking about it, and some of the campaigns that came out. And so I wrote my report, and I stayed connected with the local AIDS organization. I decided to go do a practicum there for a spring summer semester. And that's where I really began to think about the impact that HIV would have on not only the community, but my own family, who have had two spirit relatives. And at that point, began to join and to do some part-time work and do some workshops on HIV out in the First Nation communities, and began to gather with other Indigenous people in Regina who were talking about HIV that wanted to do something. And so they formed the All Nations Hope AIDS Network in 1995, and it became an organization, Indigenous AIDS organization, in 2004 under my direction. By then I was there full time. But it's always interests me because HIV has the impact to across all different sections of the health and social conditions that impact human beings. And I always wanted to get to the root of what's going on in our communities. And so that root was not always to look for the problems, but to also search for the solutions. Being very solution oriented as a woman, as an Indigenous woman, that's part of my role and responsibility, is to talk about life, to bring life, not only being a life giver, but bring life forward, bring those solutions to life that we need to look at to be able to provide that care, treatment, and support that's going to help the people that were living with HIV and AIDS. And so very early on, I knew that I was going to continue doing that work in whatever capacity I could. I'm a childbirth instructor. And so I knew that life was precious. And I knew that talking about it and taking care of it throughout the opportunities that I was given was important. So in 1999, I came full time into the AIDS world and worked as a leader in the All Nations Hope AIDS Network. And in the last 3 years became the leader at the national with the CAN, Communities, Alliances, and Networks, which was formerly the Canadian Aboriginal AIDS Network. So that's where I am today. And that definitely the art that I talk about is the art that our ancestors practiced on this land for many, many, since the beginning of time. Bringing that back to life is important to us as Indigenous people. Our language is a form of art. When we say something in Cree, that's what it means. When I say something in English, it can mean many things. So, but in Cree, our language is an art. And in any of the Indigenous languages of the world, it's an art form that we have to bring back. And I'm so thankful when I meet people that come to this land called Canada now from different countries, and they have an accent. And I'm interested in knowing where they come from and what language they speak, because that's important. And I tell them, keep your language. Teach your children, your grandchildren, those to come, your language. Keep your culture and your traditions, because that's important to you, important to your family, important to the ones to come. To know where we come from and to know where we're going is so important on this land. And the solutions that we look for in HIV and AIDS are deeply rooted in our Indigenous ways of knowing and doing. They're not rooted in any other place. So I want to thank you for that.
Thank you, Margaret. Also, thank you for going first. I do realize it is a lot of pressure, but you also set such a beautiful tone. So thank you for that. Les, now we're on to you. And I would love to hear, what is your relationship to HIV? And feel free to approach it in any way that you want. I think that your life experience with HIV means that you can speak about it from any of the directions. So I'm going to mute and off camera and throw it to you.
Well, thank you very much. I appreciate that. Well, I will look at it on a different view. And Margaret, I mean, it's hard to go after you, all the great words you're saying there and the great strength you have. So yeah, just wanted to say that. My relationship with AIDS has started pretty much at a very young age. A lot of the people I looked up to and cared about that were mentors into my life have been people in into, you know, school in the arts. One of my first teachers was Renee Highway, and that was he was a beautiful dancer, contemporary dancer, and taught us as in a school. We went to a school that we didn't have programs. We didn't have even a playground at first. We had just the room, And they came in and started teaching us these things. And it was so beautiful what we learned. And, you know, I'm a big person, always been a big person. I learned how to dance. And then I learned later on, it affected me that I danced it in cultural ways and that, right? But it was so beautiful. And as the first person, I was a young kid, and they passed away. It really made me look at the world in a different way right from that time. And that's the thing is, like, in my life, I've been involved with so many different aspects in it. And I try to keep it ground level roots. I never try to work too high into any, I've tried to work into, like, you know, on boards and stuff like that, or in management positions. Can't do it because there's something you have to do to get there. And I don't want to do some of those things. And I feel like I can do so much more with the people that I love and care about. My brother was diagnosed with HIV, and I didn't really know the actual technical things about things at that time. I knew some people that passed away. My teacher, my principal, and this one, you know, the crisis was going on. And then my brother asked me to come live with him, and I grew up with him, and just taking care of, you know, that end of life care in a beautiful way as much as possible with our culture and traditions, and also with the other parts where people didn't understand the drugs and alcohol in our community, because our culture and traditions are mainly based on abstinence. And so it's not really acceptable in a lot of our communities. So it's shunned upon a lot of people that are in that. And so I can't be around this to see anybody put down or left in the dark or anything, and not be allowed to do anything. I believe everything is beautiful and everybody's beautiful to be able to live a life and be a part of it, be a part of life here. And why wouldn't you? Why wouldn't you want somebody to be loved and be cared for? Why be have that? Why would you think only some people could? And that's the thing I've seen that as Indigenous people, we grew through generations of crisis, through pandemics, through so many things, sicknesses, and we survived everything. So many times we were told that we were going to be defeated and we would be wiped off the earth. People tried to do that. They tried to annihilate us, but they never did, and we're still here. And there's many of us that have so many things that are going on in our lives with this crisis. And the thing is, like, these things are not gone. You know, people think that they're gone. They may, numbers, look at numbers and stats. What is numbers and stats? Numbers and stats or government in a colonial way of thinking. But if you look at somebody, an individual, and as a group and as a whole, they are the same. And so if numbers are low, it's still important to why don't we have that much care anymore as we did before? Our much coverage of things, because sadly, the white male privilege was looked at and dealt with a lot more than the Black and Indigenous community here in Canada and the United States, where that's been affecting people. So my thing with that is that it was something that I believed that it wasn't a choice. It was something that was just there. And why wouldn't you do it? Why wouldn't you be a part of it? And that's how I believe on harm reduction, not to lower a barrier, but just take the barrier out of there. People say that, say that word addict, right? I don't use that word. And I've had discussions with this, and people say, well, what word do you want me to use? How about no word with that? Why would you replace a negative word to another word to change that into something else? That's been done through time and immemorial since the colonialism has started. They've always tried to take things and change the words. Everything, my name has been changed over the years, my last name, and all the things that I've been connected with I've been changed and changed my names and try to soften the blow. And why soften the blow? People are still suffering. People are still having these issues that have always been there. And we need to keep on loving each other and loving our community and having it open for everybody. Make it.
Thank you, Les. I am so grateful that we can be in this digital circle together, but I also want to say one of the hard parts about not being in physical space is that we can't clap for each other. We can't see the big smiles or the nods of recognition when people say such beautiful, profound, and true things, and everybody has said such profound things so far, and I just want you to know that I'm off camera, I'm nodding like wild. Next up, we're going to hear from Abdi. And Abdi, I'd love to hear, what is your relationship to HIV? Thank you.
Thank you. So my relationship to HIV has been something that I've known for a long time. As a gay man, you're always told that, you know, being gay is eventually you're going to contract HIV in some way, right? Which is not true, but that's what people are usually told when you're younger. But I knew about HIV from an early age, probably teenage years. But then when I started working for the AIDS service organization, APA, African in Partnership Against AIDS, that's when I was really immersed into the world of prevention and cure, right? So when I started working at APA, that's when I started really seeing how organizations were actually dealing with trying to help people prevent from catching HIV or contracting HIV. But at the same time, I came across a lot of people who are also infected or affected, right? So you have families whose parents are HIV positive, long-term survivors, but then you also have kids who are born HIV positive. And you also have people who are not actually HIV positive, but they have relatives who are HIV positive. So they're coming there for to get information of how to deal with the condition itself. And then after that, what happened is I've also been reading and watching other artists whose work is also in whose work is mainly on the themes of HIV, or maybe HIV is kind of touched on a little bit, but it's pretty much there. So works, a particular kind of artist that I've always loved to look at their work, such as Isaac Julian's film, This Is Not an AIDS Advertisement. And then you also have somebody like Johnny Noxima, who's a zine editor, filmmaker and artist living in Toronto. His first zine was Bimbox, which was released in the late 80s. And he also founded Pause Magazine in Toronto in 2007. So things like that, right? So these are the artists whose work is actually very involved with HIV stuff, including Stephen Andrews, who's, you know, like who made that series of, it's called Facsimiles, if I can pronounce it right, which is made up of images of women and men who died of HIV AIDS and this is from like 1990 to 93, the series. And then you also have artists like Sean Kelly, who uses text-based work in his art. And then you also have somebody like Mikiki, who I came across while I worked at APA. Mikiki used to work at Passand. So Mikiki is a performance artist, queer performance artist, whose work is also incorporates HIV and themes of HIV in it. So that's the way I came to, that's how I came to HIV and the involvement with HIV, right? And after that, what ended up happening is I ended up also incorporating, not directly, but indirectly, and just touching on the themes of HIV in some of my work. For instance, there's a film that I'm working on that I just finished shooting, and I'm supposed to be editing and finishing editing hopefully by the end of this year, and it should come out early next year, which is which looks at Toronto's nightlife in the 1970s before the advent of HIV/AIDS. So the nightlife, Toronto's nightlife scene in the 70s. And then I also made this other work on cruising, which is called Shadow Boxing, titled Shadow Boxing. And that work was actually kind of inspired by one of Isaac Julian's early films in 1991, Young Soul Rebels, which is about cruising also in a London park. But this shadow boxing is mostly in Toronto. So the cruising scenes in Toronto, the parks in Toronto, such as Hyde Park, Queen's Park, and those are the parks that I kind of, so I interview individuals about the experiences of cruising in these parks. And I use the audio from the interviews and incorporate it with, juxtapose it with the like visuals from the scenes of these parks in film and set it up as an installation. So that's how I also include my work. I also include HIV in my work.
Thank you so much, Abdi. I remembered to unmute in honor of everybody who's unmuting today. I love that you included your own work in that too. I think it's really important when we're thinking about HIV/AIDS to remember that it really, the reason why we have a movement is because people spoke out and spoke with. So thank you so much. I'm gonna call Theo up to talk about your relationship to HIV. And I'm gonna mute and stop my video. Thanks, Theo.
Absolutely. Thank you so much, Ted. Thank you so much, everyone on the panel, for your responses, for sharing your lived experience and your art practice, and just the stories, the storytelling that comes from conversations about HIV and AIDS. But I appreciate the question about what exactly is the connection between myself and the work I do in terms of HIV and AIDS activism and harm reduction activism. And I like the question because it really, really gets to the emotionality. It really gets to the viscerality, like the real grit behind why we're here in this room virtually having a conversation, why people rose up in the 80s and, you know, really, stood up against the government and about policies, and why there are protests against blood bans. And, you know, that question really reminds me of why I do the work I do. And to get down to it, to be real about it, as someone who is a Black, queer, trans, non-binary millennial, I think it has to be said that for individuals like me, I myself in a position where I am right now in the year 2022, looking back on queer history, queer Black history, I'm not positive myself, although I do fall within a demographic that is adjacent to being vulnerable of infections. But my connection to this issue is that I have nothing but pure rage and anger for what was lost for my generation. And I think a lot of those of you who experienced intergenerational traumas and genocides and all of those other parts of history that impact us where we are today. But as someone who is millennial in the year 2022, Black identified, queer and trans identified, my connection to HIV and AIDS is almost like, I want revenge on you because you killed my family. You know, we've lost elders, we've lost mentors, we've lost a generation of people who could have, assisted the generation of today, millennials, the generation Y, Z, whatever they call themselves now, to pass on the knowledge of queer history and queer love and queer intimacy. And so I guess my connection to this is that I kind of mourn, and there's a lot of grief and anger and rage towards what was lost for my generation because of HIV and AIDS. You know, as a queer activist, you know, there, you know, as someone who has had a lot of privilege in their life, you know, growing up, and business wise, I've had a lot of opportunities, but that's something that cannot have been in place for a lot of people like me. And, you know, I feel like in a way, my generation, especially those who are Black, queer, trans identified, have been put at a social disadvantage because of the HIV AIDS epidemic. And, you know, there is just so much rage for what has been lost for us to develop as a community, and to move forward and to heal. And so in the work that I do as an activist, as an artist, as an educator, I really focus on healing and transformation, because, you know, that is the gap that I guess my mission is to help fill for this generation of those who have lost elders. You know, bringing teaching of queer wisdom and queer love and consent and having conversations about relationship and community and things like this that we lost because we didn't have queer elders to have those conversations with us about how to love and how to have community with one another. And so that's the connection for me. And also, you know, being within a demographic of individuals who are vulnerable. And, you know, although I, at this point in my life, am not positive, who knows? Again, because of where I fall, the way the cards I was dealt, it's just a vulnerability within my intersectional identity. And I have so many friends, you know, in my close circle who are directly impacted, even those who are not directly impacted within Black, queer, trans identified community, they know someone, or they have cared for someone, or they know someone who has cared for someone who was positive or was going through an illness due to their status. So, you know, positive or not, you know, I feel as though this is a conversation we all need to be involved in, because again, intersectionally, so many of us, so many hands and so many voices can be in on this conversation to provide support and to create solutions. And so to answer your question, Ted, why am I here? Why do I care about what I do in terms of harm reduction and HIV? I'm mad as hell as a queer, Black, trans, non-binary millennial. And I want to see my generation heal from the loss of elders, of mentors. And I want to see us do well and be empowered.
That's beautiful. Thank you. And your work and everyone's work on this panel is definitely part of that healing. Abdi, Theo, Les, and Margaret, I invite you to turn your cameras on. Now is that wonderful time where we're sitting around the circle, where we get to look at each other. We get to try to not project and interpret each other's body language too much, but we get to be together in a conversation. And of course, this conversation is happening in the context of the National Gallery of Canada, who is hosting this very huge, monumental, important exhibition about a general idea, an arts collective, that made work that, you know, that really helped put contemporary art in the larger context of Canadian artwork and the art world, and of course made meaningful work about HIV/AIDS. Felix and Jorge both died with HIV in 1994. AA continues to be a part of the ongoing response to HIV. And as you all were talking, I was taking notes and I was thinking, as we have general idea in mind, as we have different histories in mind, I just want to name some of the things that were brought out. And I just want us to be imagining all these things kind of braiding together to create this tapestry that we are creating together. Community, blood bands, disability, All Nations Hope, CAN, drugs, Isaac Julian, Renee Highway, Pause Magazine, Pisan, Rage, Harm Reduction, Genocide, Survival, Vulnerability, Stephen Andrews, Trans, Lakeshore Arts, Mentorship. I hope in some of those words you heard an echo of what you shared, and maybe you heard something that you didn't quite get to pick up because of whatever. Before we go on, I want to just ask everybody on the panel, is there anybody or anything that you just want to give voice to. I'm thinking about all my friends who I have lost because of HIV, either because of death or because maybe they didn't want to talk about HIV with me anymore, so I lost them to ignorance. And I want to say that I miss my friend Bryn Kelly, who died a few years ago. I want to say that my friend Jessica Whitbread is alive and living with HIV, and I hope she's in the audience. So I'm going to be silent for a second, and I invite all of you to unmute and name anybody living, dead, present as a ghost or present, to just give some space for them as well.
Thank you so much for that, Ted. And I would love to, just virtually bring into the space all of those within the region of Peel who were served by Moyo Health and Community Services, who were lost to the opiate crisis, especially during the pandemic. It's been a really, really hard couple of years. During a period, we did lose about 16 clients who were served by one of our offices. So I have to just, speak to that and again, bring awareness to how many people have been lost over the years to opiate use and also the HIV/AIDS epidemic, and how they're interconnected. They're all interconnected.
Thank you. I wanted to give voice to two spirit men that lived in my community, and the work that they did throughout their lifetimes. Two spirit men who were recognized as leaders within their own families and in the community as helpers that served the people throughout their lifetime, right to the end, who didn't die of AIDS or with HIV. They died of other diseases. And so I wanted to just give voice for some of the ones that worked tirelessly in their lifetimes to create change and to create a place of hope for those to come. And from the two-spirit people, thank you.
It's pretty hard to do a call out sometimes because you're always worried about you're going to miss something. And I think that always scares me sometimes because I want to get everybody. I don't want to offend anybody. And, me and Ted worked on a project recently, and I'm going to show this picture what we put on the van. And as we see that there, and you can see that these are all different people that have passed away through the opiate crisis and HIV. I had the pleasure to work in with Ted and some other people, and it was such a hard thing to go through the pictures of those people. I put them upside down and put and looked at them to see who they like. So I didn't pick my favorite people that I care about, because I want to care about everybody. Everybody's wonderful and deserves to be on here, because you couldn't make a page big enough to have everybody, right? And so, just the lovely to see, their faces. And, we wish, like with the project, it was called, Wish You Were Here and Wish Things Were Different, right? Was that Ted?
Wish You Were Here, Wish You Were Better. But
wish
I like
better, yes. Wish You Were Different. I like that too. Right? Mm-hmm. But that is something that with people, I like to think about, in an indigenous community over the years, homophobia is something that has been in our communities, has plagued our communities forever. And so a lot of people that have died and people living with HIV have always had the trouble of dealing with their own communities, not the people outside of our communities. That's a whole different problem. That's another problem, and they're probably bigger, but also big that it's hard to be accepted in your own families and friends and your loved ones in your community, and you can't celebrate your culture and that. So I'd like to think about just a shout out to all those people that really had a rough time with that, of not being able to be have the love that they deserved. And I just think about that, and that's what that project made me think about that we worked on, and like what was being said there, that, you know, the harm reduction and the HIV/AIDS and the opiate crisis, there's so many connections with each other, with how it is and how it's affecting everybody, and all these other things throughout history, through the people that have been oppressed. It's always been there. Mm-hmm. Thank you very much for that.
Yeah, and I want to remember all the frontline workers during the pandemic who have been kind of, you know, helping the people who are suffering from addiction. And also, I want to remember all the people who are still alive but have been fighting and helping people who are HIV positive before the government kind of was helping them. And I also want to remember the people who have passed away because of neglect by the people who were supposed to be looking after them. So remember the story of what's his name? I can't remember his name now, but passed away at Casey House. Lee, I think his name is Lee. So he's one of the people that I used to know from a long time ago from working at the AIDS Service Organization. Like he's an activist, but he was also in between different organizations, kind of helping people out. But then to read about his how he passed away was very sad to me. So I think we still have a long way to go in terms of, like, you know, keeping up with helping people and trying to look after ourselves as well. So I just want to give a shout out to all those organizations that have been in the front line of helping people who really needed help at this time of day.
You brought up a really good point there, Abdi, about just about care too in general, and about how, I guess within the HIV community and the HIV activist community, we've sort of been forced to sort of think about what care looks like in so many different circumstances, pandemic circumstances, in so many different ways. Yeah. And then creating community connection through care as well. And, the pandemic also has given us ideas, you know, as AIDS service organizations on how we can provide care to our communities. Mental health care has been something that has come up so largely within our community at Moyo in the region of Peel, and delivering programs that provide a little bit of creative outlet for folks to, you know, cope and with the isolation. You know, they're not able to meet with those within their HIV AIDS support group or come into the office to get their services. So, you know, just having that other added layer of care is helpful as well, and finding creative outlets in order to offer that care. Important. And I know Margaret was mentioning earlier about how the Indigenous community World AIDS Day, they would wrap sweet grass in the red ribbon as well. So just, you know, culturally relevant ways to show care during some trying times.
But also when you run into homeless people on the street, people who have addiction on the street, you might not know them, but always saying hello to them and seeing how they're doing, asking them how they're doing, that is also another way of kind of helping without, you know, like sometimes you have to treat people like human beings.
You know, in the Indigenous community, we talk about harm reduction, right? And the government thinks it's a new thing. But Indigenous people have been practicing harm reduction on this land since the beginning of time. So we understand when COVID hit that our doors were open, that we didn't close our doors, that we even created new spaces for people to come. And I think that speaks to a lot to what we know as Indigenous people, that the spirit that lives in you, lives in me, lives in our creator, Kisi Manito. And we have to treat each other as that and say good morning or good afternoon to everybody. And that's a part and parcel of making people feel that they belong and that there's people that care about them. And that regardless of how they present, they are welcome to walk through the doors of the places I frequent and I have the opportunity to lead. Those are things that I think about around when we talk about harm reduction and how we've been doing this work. and how it needs to continue, and that we have to really look at what the barriers that the government, our institutions, our systems put on the people that are not making a difference, that they're creating more havoc than anything. And this whole last pandemic that came and is still here, COVID, the government really threw fear into the people about it. And so even in Saskatchewan, we're always seeing how many new cases that go every day. They counted how many new cases, how many tests, all of that. But yet we are having a HIV epidemic, our pandemic in our own communities. Today, we're seeing the output of what happened during COVID times. We're seeing the cases of HIV enormous in the prairies. In Manitoba, they released some information. You know, 7 out of 10 of the cases of HIV are Indigenous. 200 new cases, 7 out of 10 Indigenous, and majority of them women. So, you know, this is the truth we speak about. And if it happened in one province, it's happening right across the land. So, you know, there's lots of work to do, but there's lots of work we have to do together to begin to look for those solutions and bring them to life. So I think that's a good way of looking at the HIV, because it's always been that way on this land. The activists always work together with everybody. So, you know, working in unity to find those solutions and bring to life is what we should be doing, and not to rely on the government. The government's not going to save us. They haven't in the 150 years they've been here. You know, they continue to do a genocide for Indigenous people on this land, practicing that. Still alive and well here on this land called Canada.
One of the things that I'm super grateful that we're doing today is that we together are sharing of our histories of HIV. We're not relying on a timeline given to us by the government or by an art gallery. We are each sharing our own timelines of HIV. And in my own work, I look at the life of Robert Rayford. He was a Black teenager who died in 1969 in St. Louis with HIV, a fact that we learned because his tissues were saved and they were tested. And so I'm holding space for everybody who lived with this unknown, unnamed virus from who knows when, right? Like, we know that HIV entered this place we call North America many times in the 70s and 80s before we kind of gave it a name. So I'm going to hold space for those people. And I want to hold us accountable for this idea of, like, when someone is sick, we should pay attention no matter who they are, what they look like, right? So I think that many of the people who were dying first of the virus were just assumed to be, their premature death was just assumed within a white settler mindset. And I think all of us on this call reject that. And I love that. And we know through the amazing work of Vivian Namaste that much of the early cases of HIV in the land we call Canada were among people of Haitian descent, and how their lives and their deaths weren't counted early enough. So I just want to give space for all of those people and those souls who are with us. So there's two items of business. One is, dear viewers who are watching us, please use the Q&A to ask us questions. You can ask us about our outfits, our work, our beliefs, whatever. And then we have been talking a lot about history, but Theo, Abdi, Les, and Margaret, let's talk about the future. Margaret, you talked about solutions and this idea of that you're solutions based. So let's talk about the future and how we get there. So I'd love to hear from each of you. What is the future you're working towards, and how can all of us help be a part of that? And instead of starting with Margaret, because I believe in being fair, let's just start with Theo.
Sure. Great. Let me just make sure I am unmuted. The future projections, future forward. I'm all about this, just given that, you know, I'm all about moving towards a transformative future. I'm hopeful for the future, despite my negative reflections on the past. I'm hopeful for the future, and I want to be that optimist to say that, you know, we can heal that generational trauma, that queer generational trauma that has been created by the HIV AIDS pandemic within our community. And I think a lot of that will be healed by mentorship, by close community. And I see that happening now as our communities are connecting with one another. Our communities are becoming more inclusive and diverse, and we're, you know, decolonizing or making efforts to do that and become consciously aware of our intersectionality. I know it's a process on learning things that create barriers to get us to where we need to go is a process, and it may take us generations to get there, but I want to be positive, and I am positive for the future going forward. And I also want to highlight just the advances that have been made in technology and medicine with respect to HIV and AIDS. You know, how much closer are we are to a cure now than we were, you know, a decade ago, even a year ago? And I believe that a cure will be found within our lifetime. The research is getting us closer there. And I think education, research, mentorship, continuing to develop and build capacity within our communities will help alleviate some of the stress that has been caused on us because of the HIV/AIDS pandemic. So those would be my projections for the future. But again, there's still a lot of work to be done, a lot of institutions, you know, that are still holding the power and the purse strings. There's still a lot of unlearning for them to be done in terms of colonization and you know, anti-Black racist, you know, worldviews and mindsets and anti-Indigenous mindsets as well. So for those who are willing to do the work, I send you light and might to do so. And for those allies who are there to support those who do need to do the work, sending you light and might as well. But I believe it's possible, you know, we're getting to a place where we can make this history and we can heal ourselves.
Yeah, I wasn't sure what was going next, what I'm hoping for in the future is to have less stigma, because I think we still have stigma going on right now. It hasn't gone anywhere or disappeared. And so I think by getting rid of stigma and people getting comfortable with who they are and people accepting others, that would be a way for solution, for something to happen down the road, right? So because the more people are stigmatized, the less they're willing to get help or even come out and kind of discuss their conditions or anything, or even their situations. But with less stigma, I think more people will be willing to kind of like speak about their own conditions, help others without judging. And so I think stigma is one of the main elements that has to go if anything was to happen.
Gotcha. I'll go next. Future, the thing is that it's a funny thing. I try to look back at like in Indigenous cultures, we always try to look, you know, 7 years ahead, 7 years back, and we try to look at now, and all those things connect to together, right? And so we put those together, and what do we have? We have a thing like a formula that works and doesn't work, and all those things that we can see, and what we can work on and what we don't need to work on. And one thing that I've noticed, funding for and awareness to people HIV and AIDS is very a lot lower. You know, funding is not as big before, because I also believe because that has to do with racism, of it being connected to, you know, white privilege. You know, when it first hit this pandemic first hit so big, it was white people that affected largely, that had a lot of power and money. And, you know, there were a lot of people that were affected that didn't have money. The Black and Indigenous community and the other communities didn't have money. And now we have these organizations where come to the point where, like, say, Casey House has their mandate has open up more, who could be staying there and who's at that place, right? And who works at these places. But at one time, there were certain criteria you had to you have, and they're not. And so, like, I think it's honestly, it's really difficult to see that what the future is going to be and how it is, because we're looking at it in governance eyes on how things are done, and they're not there for us. The system is not created for us. It's not been created for. It is not there to cure things, to help us, and it's us as people. We have to do that, and that all things have been done through the people, not by the governments and their outlook. And so, well, that sounds really gloomy, but that's the truth. Even the thing is, like, these have been such a hard life for a lot of people that it didn't have to be. A lot of people have suffered and in pain throughout their lifetime, living with these conditions that were not necessary. Some people didn't have to live this way, but they lived this way because of the conditions they were put in as indigenous Black and Brown communities across North America. These things, these situations were forced upon us, beat, killed upon us, all these things, that blood, there's always that blood memory. So we always think about that blood memory goes further on into life. And we got to remember that later on. Who are those people? Those people have kids. Those people have, they have a thing of, bringing that into their lives, because those things still exist. There are still people that are racist. There are still people that are homophobic. There are people with all these things, but it's just that it's harder for them to say it now. And that's a scary thing too, because now before it was, you would see that with them. And but we have to deal with that on a daily basis, because we are not those people that could just walk into any place like anybody else. I can't walk into a store just like anybody else. I was talking about this on another discussion. I walked into a store that I walked into for the past 5 years, and I went in there every day, and they stopped me to check my pockets to see if I stole something. I go in there every day, and I have my badge where I work at a health center across the street. They didn't see that. And that's just like some of those things that happen with us because of what they have put upon us. So that is a thing that still exists. And I just want to have that pointed out, because it is great, all the things that we have been working on. And it's us, and it's the people that I love, my elders, my relatives, my family, my nieces and nephews. And I think it's the key issue to that. So thank you.
Thank you so much. You know, one of the things we talk about in Indigenous communities is that the work that we do here is going to have an impact on the generations to come. So I always say that the work I do today is going to is for my grandchildren and those to come. So I currently have 3 grandchildren, and I hope to have more, and I hope to see my great grandchildren, and I'll see how far I go. I just talked with somebody today at a luncheon, and we're talking about the 2 ceremonies that we know as Indigenous people that you come here that you can never not participate in, because you're the main attraction, which is when you're born here and when you leave here. And, you know, one of my kokum talks about when people are born here on this land, the babies, they cry because they're leaving that place that we come from, where our ancestors are. We are leaving that place. And when we come to this place called Earth, it's a very hard life. And we're coming here to learn teachings, things that we have already made. This is a Cree creation story. We've made commitments to do with the Creator. We've told the Creator, this is what we'll do when we come to Earth and experience what we're here to experience. So we come here, our first ceremony being born, that birthing ceremony is so important for our people to go back to and to stay, to not have a hospital birth, but have a birth that you're surrounded by your kokum and your mom and your sisters and your your daughters, whoever is there, that is the woman, women in your family that will help bring a baby into this, a spirit into this world. And then the other ceremony that you can't get out of is when you die, when you leave here. And that should be a joyous celebration of your life, of what you did here while you were here. And people should be happy for you that you've gone on, you've done what you said you'd do, and now you're going back home. You're going to that place that you came from. And those are things that, that's the, it's very different when you sit and listen to other nations, other nations of people from, not from this land called Canada, other like England and Scotland and those places, they talk differently about the death ceremony. Right. And so we've incorporated some of those ways here on this land called Canada. And one of the things I talked about is that my kokum talks about how she's made of moose meat and berries. You're made of whatever your parents ate when you were being created and you're being with your mother. And so when she leaves here, she's going to go back to the earth and she's going to turn back into moose meat and berries. Right. And so those are things that we think about and how there's so much laws here. So I said, why can't people get buried where they want to get buried and how they want to get buried? But there's laws that say you have to have this certain way. And this one man piped up and he talked about how your body is toxic to the earth. So that's why the people on the land called Canada to make rules about what has to happen during your burial. And you have to be buried in a certain place and they have to take all the toxins out of you before you're buried. Then I chimed in and said, but yet the government can put other toxins in the water and in the earth. So it's only a money-making control thing, right, that they came here and did. Because I believe that, as we move forward, I want to leave a legacy for my children, my grandchildren, my great-grandchildren, those to come, that will say, Margaret stood up for people living with HIV. She didn't sit down. Margaret stood up for Indigenous ways of knowing and doing. Margaret stood up for the medicines, for the water, for the land, for the people that were being impacted the greatest. Margaret kept standing up and she didn't sit down. And she did this all of her life. And at the end of her life, she caught babies because that's what she loves doing, is bringing babies into the world and singing them in here and telling them and good things and making sure that they have those supports among their families that will help them through the rites of passage as they begin from girl to boy, from girl to boy, from girl to woman. That sort of, those rites of passages. And our two-spirit people and our transgenders people, we have about 11 genders that we talk about on this land before the colonizers came here and start naming us man, women, and other. We had 11 genders. And you know, our ancestors, our old people, our elders, they tell us that our spirit is neither male or female. We present how we present physically, but our spirits are not that. And so, you know, those are things that we know as Indigenous people. That's why we have a problem in our languages saying he or she, or we don't have words for that. I remember my old auntie would call, we would giggle because she would call us, if I'm a girl, she'd call us he. Like she would use he or she interchangeably. She would, because we didn't have nothing like that, right? So I giggle at certain things, but those are things that I want to leave. I want to leave a legacy of hope for the generations to come and to leave this kind of hope across the land. And I've been told over times and time again that my voice will be heard, not by just individuals, but by thousands and thousands of people, that I would have that voice. And that's the gift the Creator gave me, to be able to speak life, Pamasawin, to the people on this land and all the right across this land. I'm going to Thailand on Friday to speak life over there, but be respectful because I'm a visitor there. I'm not from that land. I'm from this land, but I'll go there and speak about the truth and reconciliation that's happening on this land called Canada and how the government has put that in action. And what does that really mean? You know, a short story about me is my last name is Kisikaw Piyesis, and that's my father's family name before the colonizers came here and changed his last name to Bitternose. So I took back that name, Kisikaw Piyesis. And when government officials and whoever else says it, it's reconciliation in your own families, because maybe it was your family that was part of taking that name away from my family. But now when you say it so openly, our ancestors are so happy. Your ancestors, my ancestors are happy that name is back here on this land, because this is the land of my ancestors, Kisikaw Piyesis. Thank you. And it means daybird in Cree. Thank you.
Everybody gave so much richness there. And I think part of having hope is sitting with the hard truth that we know to be true and still knowing that we're going to do the work. And I feel like the four of you gave us that. We have one very generous question that came from the folks that are doing the behind the scenes work. And we don't have much time left, but I want to give it voice and I want to just offer it as a ponderance. And if you have something to say, feel free to share. If you don't have anything to say, it's okay. We can always wrap up and that we can carry the question in our heart. So the question is, I'm interested in hearing from the panelists about the transformative nature of art as healing, how it connects to our heritage when making, and then can expand a viewer's horizon and empathy when present. Panelists have talked about loss, healing, generation gaps, and making art. So do any of you have anything to say about the transformative, that's not a word, but I'm making it a word, the transformative power of art before we wrap up?
You know, one of the things I want to just mention is the AIDS quilts and how that was very early on and it's still evident today. It's still here. We still present those quilts in the national, international work that we do. And so that's very, very transformative, very art, and it's still here. Also for Indigenous people, the art of making our own regalia, or the art of making our own, this is my sacred feather, an eagle feather that was gifted to me. And I take it where I go and I use it because it helps me to speak, to tell the truth. And also use it in sharing circles because when you hold this feather, you cannot tell the lies. And it's kind of interesting because it's brought out a lot of truth in people, right? When they start talking about their own ancestors. And some people don't know who their ancestors are. They don't know what country they come from. They don't know what language they spoke. They don't know any of the traditions and the cultures of their ancestors. And that's really sad. That's why I say Indigenous people on this land called Canada, we are very rich people. You know, even though we have the highest statistics of HIV and addiction and go on and on, we are still very rich because we know who we are. We know who our ancestors are. We know our languages, our traditions, our cultures, our many forms of art that we speak about here. And so those are things that I think about. Thank you.
Sure, I can definitely speak to,
go ahead, you're good.
Yeah, I can definitely speak to the transformative nature of using art in teaching and in community engagement and activism. Something that I absolutely love to teach, and I've been teaching it for a few years now, is the West African medicine wheel, which is something that was sort of written on by a West African teacher from Burkina Faso by the name of Maladoma Somme, who actually passed on in the past year or so, actually. And during the pandemic, I created pretty much like a replica of that West African medicine wheel. That you can see here, a little bit blurry, but it's something that I used in my own recovery process, just as a tool to learn more about myself, my ancestral history, how I can understand myself and my journey in recovery through the cosmology of my ancestors and just reframing the current situation that you're in at the moment in order to position yourself into a place where you can imagine a different world for yourself and for everyone else in the future. And so this is a tool that's been really helpful for me in my creative practice, the West African medicine wheel. There's other creative things that folks use in the Afro-Caribbean Black community, like a part of my practice right now is using a West African tribal masks in recovery to externalize what's happening in the process of addiction and craving. And so, yeah, there's different ways that you can incorporate, you know, ancestral artistic practices in that process of change and transformation and recovery. And so, yeah, there's different ways you can use it as a tool, a teaching tool. And I think art as a tool for teaching is going to be a huge thing for us, you know, moving out of the pandemic and moving forward as we heal from the HIV AIDS pandemic.
Yeah. That's great. I just wanted to know, where would you find something more about that medicine wheel?
Yeah, actually I did a video on it. If you want to Google it, you can just Google West African medicine wheel.
And there's definitely, definitely will.
Yeah, there's awesome. A YouTube. I did a talk on it for a gallery and you can find me in there.
Awesome. I just wanted to show something here for quickly. It's a self-promotion there, right? It's an art piece I did at the Brickford Center. It's a mural I did. And this article is in Broken Pencil magazine. But it's woodland style art, which I was very fortunate, as I said earlier, talked to and worked with and learned from Norvell and his kids. To this day, I still do work with David, his son, and Christian had just passed on this past week. And I've been so lucky that is when you talk about the woodland artwork, is that the lines are such a strong thing. And if you ever look at his Norvell stuff, a lot of it has double duplicates of things. And what that represents is this life here and the next life we go to, how the dualities that they have and what they are and the journeys that we have. That's what's so important, that those are, that we know that and understand what happens here is a good part of the other world too. And in there, there's a like a syringe there. That's a needle with fentanyl in it because it's purple, right? That you see it in that. And that was a thing that has never been incorporated in that kind of artwork before. And that's the thing I'd like to, you know, add those things and see those things. And because those are parts of our lives. Those are parts of all of our lives. And there's nothing to be ashamed of that. There's nothing to be, you know, and that one thing I just like, that word addiction, is if we could try to shy away from that, you know, people that are addicts, there's nobody that's an addict. You are who you are, what you are, and you're a lovely person. And that's something, your substance use, and we don't have to call it something else. We don't have to rename it. It's just, it's a thing that has been put upon us as Black and Indigenous people throughout history. All these medicines, these drugs, and all have been here before, but they were put upon us to make us look not in power and look inferior. And so just to, to have that. And I loved this panel. Thank you so much.
Yes, Les, thank you for starting us on the thanks. Margaret, Les, Theo, Abdi, this was such a pleasure. I want to thank our ancestors. I want to thank everyone who's on the planet with us right now. I want to thank everyone who's going to come with us in the future, because this is going to be on YouTube, and Margaret's great-grandchildren, great-great-grandchildren are going to watch this and think, what a bunch of geniuses. And love to everybody. Thank you to the National Gallery of Canada and to David. And of course, much love to everybody who is living with and impacted by HIV. I say goodnight.